The numbers are rolling. Good morning, dear saints. Church of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. Not Christianity. Christianity is not the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. It is not. Which Jesus are you talking about? Anyway, good morning. See this? Yeah, it has the Apocrypha. The Apocrypha is not inspired scripture. This was a gift, okay? A very well-used gift. But you see that? You see that? This is God's perfect, inerrant, given by inspiration word, okay? So please, okay? When you use Bibles to attack Christians, Satan, you're trying to cast out Satan with Satan, okay? The authorized version is God's preserved word. The Bible's ain't. And I recently found that one son of Ishmael Muslim dude, our enemy, but at least the guy got enough sense to point out the obvious, okay? This is God's word, the authorized version. The Bible's ain't. Atheists and Muslims can figure that one out. Please get the authorized version of the scriptures. And please read along with me, word for word, verse by verse, at the scriptures we will be looking at today. This ain't milk. Even though it's going to be kind of milky, this is going to be me. Even though it's going to be kind of milky, okay? Read along with me, okay? Read along with me, all right? I sometimes skip a groove. My mouth goes quicker than my brain. I'm not a perfect Blackpoolian Englishman who never makes mistakes. I make mistakes. So, read along with me. Word for word, verse by verse, at the scriptures we will be looking at today. Read along with me. Be a Berean. Search the scriptures daily. What do these things be so? Okay? Go on. Get the scriptures. Confrontation with the Jesus who is. Deuteronomy chapter 18. Let me put this in the air for you. Have you ever been accused of something you never done? Who hasn't? Have you ever accused anyone before? Of course you have. I have. You have. We all have. In this video, we are going to be addressing that in a respect of being accused of something that you never did, or being accused of something falsely because of hatred for what you represent. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 on to verse 19. To stop. This is under the law, in the dispensation under the law, which was faith and works. Eternal security was not there. It is not by grace through faith from beginning to end. Anyway, prophecy. The Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. Now, Moses was a Levite of Israel. Okay? The Hebraic Jews are from Shem. Shem. Dear friend, I knew this about you from the get-go, but you've kind of touched on it. Dear friend, Bruce, Jesus Christ is not a Hamite. Jesus Christ is not a Japhethite. Jesus Christ is a Hebrew. The Hebrews come from Shem. Just saying. Okay? Just saying. Proof? Can prove that for you? Prove it. What is a Jew? Go check it out. I think you have. But whatever. But the Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. And what's interesting is the son of Ishmael. Ishmael is the firstborn. And you read in scriptures about the right of the firstborn. Okay? And the son of Ishmael, the Muslim, will catapult off of that argument. Well, hey, Ishmael, and yes, they are right. But see, it is in Isaac thy seed is called. Isaac. God chooses. God chooses. It's not that ridiculous Calvinism nonsense. Okay, that's stupid. That's stupid. Someone with a lot of pride within themselves who has never been broken of their self-righteousness can readily fall for Calvinism or abhor it. Because the God of Calvinism is cruel, vindictive, coercive. The God of Christianity is cruel and vindictive. Because Christians tell you that God loves you unconditionally. And that one Muslim dude, he even points it out. It's like, look at this. Give me a break. Okay? But, like Moses, meaning, the Lord thy God will raise up unto thee a prophet from the midst of thee of thy brethren, like unto me. Unto him ye shall hearken. According to all that thou doest, desirest of the Lord thy God in Horeb, in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, neither let me see this great fire any more, that I die not. What are we reading to? Verse 19. And the Lord said unto me, they have well spoken that which they have spoken. I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren, like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I command him. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, Jehovah saves, Jesus Christ. Jehovah saves, Jesus Christ, Mashiach, anointed one. Okay? And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken unto my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. In your Bible, do they mess with that verse? I bet you they do, don't they? We need to remember, okay? Hebrews. Hebrews. Who is the book of Hebrews written onto? Gotta rightly divide the word of truth. Or else, God's ashamed of you. Hebrews 7, verses 11 on to verse 16. If therefore, perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law. Yes, the dispensation of the law. Garden of Eden, the patriarchal period, then the law. Okay? Rightly dividing the word of truth. What further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? For the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. Meaning, we don't have to keep the law today in order to be right with God or to be saved. You can't keep it. You mess it up at one point, you mess the whole thing up. Okay? Like we've talked about. The law is there to let you know, number one, what sin is, and number two, that you at your best could never keep God's perfect requirements. He did that to show us, mankind, that you need a Savior, someone bigger than you. One God, yeah, who's comprised of spirit, soul, and body, like you and I are. We're made in the image of God. Fluffy isn't, okay? Yeah, amen, man. Attack that satanic Wicked Jesuit Babylonian created Trinity all day. Go right ahead. Go ahead. I'll cheer you on. Go ahead. All right? One God in three persons. That's stupid. Anyway. For he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. This is why one of the myriad of reasons why religion hates the Jesus who is. The Jesus who is the Father. Okay? And you want to know about, the Son of God, Son of Man, Son of David. That was explained, I believe, in the previous video. If not there, then the one before that. Okay? We've explained that. Okay? I'll try to remember which one that's in. Okay? The where we go over the Son of stuff about the Lord. Okay? He is the Father. He claimed to be. He never said, I am God. You're right. He said, I am. That's all he needed to do. Okay? For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah. Judah. Judah, a son of Jacob. Jacob, a son of Abraham. Okay, son of Isaac, son of Abraham. Taken from Shem, not Ham. Listen, dude. Jesus Christ is not a black man. Jesus Christ is not a Caucasian. Jesus Christ is not Japanese. He's a Hebrew. Comprende? He's a Hebrew. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest, who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. What does that mean? Well, Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22. You read this in the Bible. Go ahead. It's totally messed up. That's why you need the authorized version, son. Okay? Go ahead and attack Christianity with their Bibles. Go ahead. Go ahead. See, you read your Bible, it says something different in the scriptures than your little stupid Bible. Okay? You heard what I said. Genesis 22, verse 8. And Abraham said, my son, who's he talking to? Ishmael? No, he's talking to Isaac. My son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went both of them together. Himself. Who is on the cross? Come on. Come on. Who was? I'm writing down video links. Who was on the cross? Okay, we answered that. All right. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, capital W, capital C, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. Jesus Christ is the Father. He is God the Father. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Okay? The Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. Question, is that happening right now? No, no, no. The time of Jacob's trouble is coming. And then after that, the kingdom of heaven. Then eternity. Okay. Upon the throne of David, son of David, not his biological son, okay, and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Hey, you dude, One message, dude. You're a big time guy. I doubt you watch a guy like me. But, you know, you Muslims, I truly believe, are going to be the scapegoat, the patsy, during the time of Jacob's trouble, because the world is going to need an enemy to go after. They ain't going to go after the Christians. The Christians are in Satan's back pocket. They ain't. Okay? We, the body of Christ, get redeemed before the time of Jacob's trouble, and then all Hades is going to break loose. Okay? The Christians ain't going to be the problem. Okay? Your, what was it, the dome of the rock, the thing of Omar, or whatever it is, wherever that is, that's going to be demolished, and the third temple is going to be rebuilt. I have talked with several of you sons of Ishmael, and virtually every single one of you has said the same thing. If that thing, where is it, in Jerusalem, the dome of the rock gets annihilated, and they start building a Jewish third temple there, you guys, you said it yourself, you guys would go nuts. You're going to go call jihad on that stuff. And then that man of sin, the son of perdition, is going to go after you. And guess what? Dear son of Ishmael, your religion was predicated to you by Rome. Check out the videos concerning you sons of Ishmael. It's on this channel. Go ahead. I feel sorry for you guys because Satan, you know, that man of sin, the son of perdition, he'll be inhabited by Satan. He's going to use you people as a scapegoat to be the enemy of the world, to get everyone around him to attack the common enemy, which I believe is going to be you guys. But see, in order for you to evade that, you have to do something that you, by nature, that Ishmaelic thing of yours, you're going to have to love a Jew. And not that Jesus, who God loves you. You Muslims, at least, when you're presented with a Christian, you know, one God and three persons, God loves you unconditionally. You do like what that nitwit Dade Murphy does and uses the same arguments that he does and destroy Christians. Roll up another one, okay? But now, okay, go to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, okay? Jesus Christ is God the Father. All right? Check out the playlist if you have any questions. John 1. You know, God will, what does it say again in Genesis 22? Check that verse in your Bible there, friend. Genesis 22, verse 8. Check it. Does it say this? Slow down and read it carefully. This is one of the big ones that the Bibles mess up purposely. Why? Because this is you can point to one of the clear evidences that Jesus Christ is God the Father. And Abraham said, "My son, God will provide himself a lamb." There's no comma. There's no nothing there. God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. So they went, both of them together. John chapter 1, 29 on to 32. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, After me cometh a man who is preferred before me, for he was before me, and I knew him not. But that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water. John bare record, saying, I saw the catalyst spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him." See, water baptism is identification. It's an outward profession of an inner conversion. Roman Catholicism, Pentecostals, Campbellites, Lutherans, German Catholics, also are under the persuasion that it's salvific. It isn't. It's identification. That's why Jesus was baptized. Not because he God manifest in the flesh. The flesh of Jesus Christ was sinful. Yes. Yes, it was. Okay. But God manifest in the flesh did something that man cannot do. He kept the law perfectly. Henceforth, Jake the jerk, henceforth, that flesh that was sinful was sanctified by God doing what no man could do, keeping the law perfectly. Okay? Judge not. We go over it. Okay? 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Just one. 3:16. Isn't that funny? Isn't that funny? let's read 15 and 16. If I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth, not Christianity. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the capital S Spirit. That's significant because it signifies the Lord himself. Seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. See, the Jesus who is one God. Not three persons that make one God. Okay? The Jesus who is confronting. The Jesus that ain't, I've heard this. How many of you have heard this? Jesus doesn't come in front of you to oppose you. He comes alongside you. Really? 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 Dude, go back to Deuteronomy 18, okay? And let's pick up now verses 20 on to verse 22, okay? Contrast. 20 on to verse 22 in Deuteronomy 18. But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, Jesus says, I am come in my Father's name, Jehovah saves. If someone else comes in his own name, him you will receive. But the prophet which shall presume to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or that shall speak in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. And if thou say in thine heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord hath not spoken? Who's answering the prayer? Gotta write that down. If I don't write these down, I forget. Who's answering the prayer, okay? Why didn't you do that before? Not that they come to me as we're going. Anyway. And if thou say in thine heart, how shall we know the word which the Lord hath not spoken? When a prophet speaketh in the name of the Lord, if the thing follow not nor come to pass, that is the thing which the Lord hath not spoken. But the prophet hath spoken it presumptuously, thou shalt not be afraid of it. What are you saying? You Pentecostals, Catholics, huh? What are you saying? Well, God is answering my prayers. Who's answering them? Who's answering them? You gotta remember, Satan can answer prayers too. Yeah? Which God are you praying to, boy? And to answer this first, let's go to Jeremiah 23. Jeremiah 23, okay? Speaking presumptuously. Jeremiah 23, verses 21 on to 22. I have not sent these prophets, yet they ran. They run to the forefront. They want to be in the limelight. Like that idiot Scott. He wants to be in the limelight. He wants to be like the guy he's emulating. Okay, a lot of you too. A lot of you. You're not a true Christian. You only have 500 subscribers. Praise the Lord. I don't want thousands of subscribers, you nitwit. I don't want that. Keep me small and humble. Praise the Lord. Because it's not about me. It's about the Lord. God's the God of the little guy. Okay? And when you get these guys who are getting in the thousands and thousands and thousands, their pride can get involved. They, when men start putting them on a high horse. Okay? Come on now. But see, the false will run to the front. They want to be noticed. They want to be, hey, look at me, look at me. I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. You know, a little pretentious, you know, a little pretentious. I have not sent these prophets, yet they ran. Yeah, they run. They want to be in the front. They want to be the man or the woman of the hour. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied. But if they had stood in my counsel and had caused my people to hear my words, then they should have turned them from their evil way and from the evil of their doings. But what does Christianity do? God loves you. God's not angry of you, at you. Just believe and receive. How stupid. How stupid. Yeah. The Trinity is meant to confuse you. Yeah, it is, because God's not the author of confusion. Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey, you're a Christian? Come join our little cult group, our little thing here, and be a combatant with others. That's Christianity for you, man. Then run to the front. They run to the front. Deuteronomy 13. And they prophesy. They sure do. Sometimes things come to pass. Now see, that is not a contradiction. What's going on? Deuteronomy 13, 1 through 5. If there arise among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, they're coming for me, and giveth thee a sign or wonder. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22. The Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. And the sign or the wonder come to pass. Why? Whereof he spake unto thee, saying, let us go after other gods, which thou hast not known, and let us serve them. Satan can answer prayers too. Thou shalt not hearken unto the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord, now look at this, look at this, look at this, read it slowly. For the Lord your God proveth you, to know whether ye, plural, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. See, atheists will come to this and say, you say God knows everything. Then why did he tempt Abraham? That knowing, now I know that thou fearest the Lord, he experienced that fear of the Lord, okay, with Abraham. It was a relational knowing, not just a mere head knowledge. Okay? Right here, same thing. For the Lord your God proveth you. You, to who? Yourself. To know whether ye love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. God knows you. Not all by relational. Because if that were the case, then everybody would be saved, right? They just don't know it. Try telling that to Dave Murphy. You'd be wasting your time. Because he don't want the Jesus who is. Christianity don't want the Jesus who is. Okay? They want the Jesus who is not and will never be. See, God is proving to you, yourself, not to him, because he's outside of time. He can see the beginning to the end. He knows what's going to happen. We don't. You do know that, right? So, who's proving what to who? The Lord is proving you to yourself whether, because hey, with their mouth they shew much love, but their heart goeth after their covetousness. Ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Ye shall walk after the Lord your God and fear him and keep his commandments and obey his voice, and ye shall serve him and cleave unto him. And we don't do this today because, number one, this was a different dispensation. Number two, as it talks about in the book of Romans, that vengeance is mine, I will repay. These guys are going to have a lot bigger thing to deal with than us, okay? The Lord. All right? So that's why we ain't doing this today, just simply. And that prophet or that dreamer of dreams, a lot of these Hermetic Pentecostal women who've I've dreamed the dream, it's stupid. Stupid. Dear Hermetic brethren, my dear Hermetic brethren, sorry, shall be put to death. Because why? Because he has spoken to turn you away from the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt and redeemed you out of the house of bondage, to thrust thee out of the way which the Lord thy God commanded thee to walk in. So shalt thou put evil away from the midst of thee. Put evil away from the midst of thee. You know what you do? You take your little Sharpie and you mark that, then go to King James Bible Online and put in a phrase match, put evil away from among thee, put the evil away from the midst of thee. Check that out and see the context in which that appears. Okay? Because a lot of atheists will say, your God is cruel. Look what he did to the Canaanites and stuff like that. Yeah, he did. Because they did things that he abhorred. Okay? Simply put. Simply. And it's always funny. The guys who come up with that are the same ones who say that abortion isn't murder. They're the same ones that ain't got a problem with sodomite marriage. Might have a problem with sodomite marriage, but they're for abortion. Woman's rights. I know of a woman who had a rape baby. Women's rights. What about the right of that child? Oh, but you, that's right, you atheists are progressive and evolving. You sure are. But see, Exodus 32, verses 7 and 8. And the Lord said unto Moses, go, get thee down, for thy people which thou broughtest out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. About the thing about the calf. One calf which they declared to be their gods, plural. Nimrod, Semiramis, and Tammuz, or Ninus, the son of Nimrod, who Semiramis, the queen of heaven, married. There's your trinity. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. The word quick in scripture usually is associated onto being alive or lively. Look at that verse with that, knowing that. They have turned aside quickly. They were went real speedily to dance and party around the gods that they made. The gods that they made symbolized in a golden calf. Quickly, lively. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? More alive and ready to celebrate that which is evil, rather than waiting on the Lord. They have made them a molten calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed unto it. And here, look at this. And said, these be thy gods, plural, O Israel, which have brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. God is one God. One God. Amen. You and I are made in the image of God. We have a spirit. We have a soul. We have a body. Okay? Look at that verse. A, singular, molten calf. A, you can't get away from that. These be thy gods, plural. So, we see the concept of a molten calf, which are attributed to be gods more than one. We see that this is something that the Lord abhors, hates. Trinitarian, you are not worshiping the God of Scripture. You are worshiping something that began in Babylon, was crafted in Egypt, perfected in Rome. You are worshiping false gods. And amen to the atheists and the son of Ishmael who have brains enough to point that out to you. But then again, you know, and to you sons of Ishmael, you won't see this, but you got to remember this. These Christians have been ingrained with that satanic teaching of one God and three persons. That does not mean that they're totally innocent, but they're ignorant. They don't know better because that, from the inception of the Roman Catholic Church, that was their very first doctrine that they taught. So we as saints, we got to, you know, be gracious because they don't know better. Most of the times, they don't want to. They don't want to. Go to Mark chapter 10. See, the God of Scripture, the Jesus who is. I've heard that before. Where, you know, some of these Christians, it's like, well, God doesn't stand in front of you to oppose you. No, he comes up alongside of you. And they go to the road, they use the example of the road to Emmaus. But then if you were to continue reading that, he upbraids them for their unbelief. Okay? Not those guys particularly, but it's like, you know, he upbraids them for their unbelief of what the prophets have talked about in the scriptures and stuff like that. Okay? But see, the Jesus who is very confronting. Matthew chapter 10, a couple of one verse references here. One verse, 21. Matthew chapter 10. Mark chapter 10. Excuse me. See? That's why I tell you, you read along with me. Okay? I'm not a Blackpoolian Englishman who never makes a mistake. Or a guy from out north, northeast who never makes a mistake. Or who rather covers them up. Mark chapter 10, verse 21. See, the love of Christianity is don't scare them. Don't scare them. We need to get them into the church building so we can get the money. Love is truth. If you love someone, you're going to tell them the truth. Not like a jerk. But you don't need to be. If you do it like the Lord does, it's going to offend people. Verse 21 in Mark chapter 10. Then Jesus, this is the rich young ruler again. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him. Loved him. And said unto him, one thing thou lackest. See, that's the Jesus who is. The Jesus who is. When he calls you the way of the cross, the elect chosen way of the cross, the way he chose, he doesn't come alongside you and butter your... No, he opposes you. There's something you lack. One thing thou lackest. Go thy way and sell whatsoever thou hast and give to the poor. And thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross and follow me. Let's read verse 22. And he was sad at that saying and went away grieved, for he had great possessions. See, the God who is confronts you. The God who is always puts his finger on that one thing you lack. That's the God who is. That's the Jesus who is. Matthew 4, verse 17. The first words of Jesus' public ministry. Verse 17, Matthew 4. God loves you. No. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. I'm going from unbelief to belief. Oh, shut up, you fake grace idiot. Thou believest there is one God, thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble. No, the repenting is turning away from yourself that you are God's. That's the repenting. Not going from unbelief to belief, you evil idiot. And you're not, a lot of you ain't idiots. Okay? But you're willfully ignorant. And majority of you do seem to be serving the Vatican. So. But he said to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And also, go back to Mark. Mark chapter 1, verses 14 on to verse 15. Now, kingdom of heaven, in the book of Matthew only, is always a reference onto the physical, literal kingdom, where the Lord Jesus Christ will come back at his second coming and rule and reign from at Jerusalem. Kingdom of God is usually a reference onto the spiritual kingdom. Okay? The spiritual. It can be a reference onto the kingdom of heaven, but that's the sandwich, the context. Okay? So we see here. But the point is, Mark chapter 1, verses, where am I? 14 and 15. Now after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. They're not one and the same thing. There could be a reference onto it. Yes. Right here, no. No. See, the Jews had to believe that Jesus who was, is who he says he is. Son of David, King of the Jews. Son of man, Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Son of God, God manifest in the flesh. Very simple to understand. Very simple. Okay? And go to Luke chapter 5 now. Go to Luke chapter 5. But, see, but, Luke chapter 5, verses 36 on to verse 39. See, Jesus came offering the kingdom of heaven, the physical kingdom of heaven. And with him as king, it all works. The Pharisees and the Sadducees, who love the uppermost rooms in the synagogues, modern equation, the Christians who love their buildings and the suit and ties and the thousands or millions of subscribers or followers or whatever, that was put in jeopardy because the king was coming. So what happens? And he spake also a parable unto them. Now, Pentecostals, charismatics, will come to this and try to weave in the thing about, Holy Ghost. No. No man putteth a piece of a new garment upon an old. Did we not just read in Hebrews about a change in the law, right? Yeah. See, the Pharisee and the Sadducee, Pharisee is someone who puts tradition above the scriptures. That's what Catholics are. Tradition! Which goes over scripture. And yes, Rome gave you the Bible. God gave us the scriptures. There's a difference. No man putteth a piece of a new garment upon an old. If otherwise, then both the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles. So this is the one that the Pentecostals come to. Else the new wine will burst the bottles and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. No man also having drunk old wine straightway desireth the new, for he saith the old is better. Pharisees, they didn't want to let go of their authority, of people going to them, giving them things of rabbi, the Reverend so-and-so, okay, Pastor so-and-so, okay, the old is better. They didn't want the king. They didn't want the Lord. They wanted to remain in their little niche, or niche, whatever you want to pronounce it, and just be comfortable. And see, these are the same people who had ought to have known that Jesus is the Christ, but they didn't. Okay? That's what he means. I've had 100-year-old wine before. You know, I have. Okay, it tastes good. Does that mean I would have paid $1,200 for a bottle of wine? Absolutely not! Okay? But they don't want to change. They like it how it is. Catholicism, you devils, you're serving a Christ that's still on a cross. You don't know if you're going to heaven. And if you say you do, it's only out of pride because you're all combative and you're serving Satan anyway. But see, they don't want it to change. And see, the God of Scripture, the God of Scripture, the Jesus who is, it's very confronting. That's why so many of you avoid him. That's why so many of you will go to a Bible that suits your fancy. And when you do that, you get an atheist or a Muslim that comes around and rips you to shreds because the Bibles are a joke. From Rome. And they contradict each other, which that one Muslim dude points out himself. Okay? All right? The Jesus who is a God who confronts you. He doesn't come alongside you and, oh, little baby, God loves you unconditionally. No. No. John 5. I've got to put a mark here so I can remember where to take up because I put this out of place. John 5. 43 on to verse 47. John 5. 43. Not 6, Brad. John 5. Verses 43 on to verse 47. I am come in my Father's name. Jehovah saves. Jesus. And ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive. Luther, Calvin, Ruckman, Campbell. The list goes on and on. How can ye believe, which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only? Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. Accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust. See, they didn't believe the Scripture, though. That's the point. That's the point. But see, the Lord is pointing to the Scripture. For had ye believed Moses, ye would have believed me, for he wrote of me. See, the Lord here is uplifting the Scriptures. How does the Lord confront you? Right here, the Scriptures. And see, when you have a counterfeit like the Bibles that contradict each other, then why should anyone take Christianity seriously? Right? Except for you to feel good and get your best life now. But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words? And see, this is why so many of you avoid the Jesus who is. That's why so many of you go to, I can't understand the King James Version. Yes, you can. You just don't want to. You're educated and you can't get thou, thee, ye, thine, begat. But you're highly educated. You're progressive. And you can't understand that, huh? Wow. You don't want to. That's the thing. See, this cuts you. The authorized version, God's perfect, inerrant, given by inspiration word, is designed to first cut you to shreds. Either prick your heart or cut you to the heart. If you get a little prick of the heart, then, brother, what shall we do? Cut to the heart. Psalm 119. Teth. I'm not going to give you the verse numbers today. Psalm 119. Teth. Psalm 119. I'm not going to give you the verse numbers. Learn how to decipher Psalm 119 through the Hebraic thing, the verse, the thing above the little bracket of eight verses there. Psalm 119. Teth. The Teth, right? Yes. Thou hast dealt well with thy servant, O Lord, according unto thy word. Teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I have believed thy commandments. Before I was afflicted, I went astray, but now have I kept thy word. Thou art good and doest good. Teach me thy statutes. The proud have forged a lie against me, but I will keep thy precepts with my whole heart. You are your own God, but I will keep thy precepts with my whole heart. Their heart is as fat as grease, but I delight in thy law. Yeah, full of themselves. It is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes. Again, before the Lord Jesus Christ could be any kind of a glory unto you through his word, he first has to rip your head off. He's going to cut you. He's going to debilitate you. He's going to humiliate you. He's going to break you. He's going to devastate your categories. He's going to get you on the ground. But see, not of coercion. He's not going to coerce you. Because the Jesus who is very confronting. He stands opposed to you. Not next to you. If he saves you, then he will come by you every once in a while. But number one, remember, he's God. We ain't. The law of thy mouth is better unto me than thousands of gold and silver. Look across to Mem. Oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. Thou through thy commandments hast made me wiser than mine enemies. For they are ever with me. Statutes, judgments, precepts, commandments. Where do you find those? Scriptures. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the ancients because I keep thy precepts. I have refrained my feet from every evil way that I might keep thy word. I have not departed from thy judgments. For thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words unto my taste. Yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore I hate every false way. I hate Catholicism. I hate Islam. I hate Jehovah's Witnesses. Ism, their religion. I hate Mormonism. Guess what? I hate Christianity. Oh. This is not the faith that was once delivered unto the saints. Even from these King James Bible-believing Christians. That's not the faith that was once delivered to the saints. It's not. You guys have made it a members-only club, and it is. But see, you take it to a carnal level, and you boast about it. No wonder no one wants the real Jesus. Especially when you run into some of these King James Bible believing Christians. Okay? And of course, Hebrews chapter 4, one verse, verse 12. Hebrews 4, verse 12. For the word of God is quick, alive, see? And powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow. That's a body. That's a person. Spirit, soul, and body is a person. And is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. See, you guys, you don't want the God who is. That's why you avoid the authorized version. That's why you go to a Bible. You don't want the God who is, because the God who is, you get a hold of his word, he's going to just cut you to shreds. And you know it. That's why you avoid it. You know it. That's why you will accept readily. God loves you. Prove me wrong. Please. Don't prove me wrong. Try to prove the scriptures wrong on that. Then again, you believe what you're reading, huh? Now, 1 Corinthians chapter 4. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. People who want to justify sin will come to this and twist it in order to say, well, you can't judge me. Only God could judge me. How does God judge you? We kind of already looked at it through his word, the scriptures. Hence, a saint has every right to, number one, judge ourselves through the scriptures, but also to judge you. Yes, bloke. Saints are fruit inspectors. That's why y'all are afraid of saints. Verses 1 on to verse 5 in 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. But with me it is a very small thing that I should be judged of you or of man's judgment. Yea, I judge not mine own self. Why is Paul saying that? Because he knows that man's judgment is flawed. Okay? Man, ye shall be as gods. Man, good is evil. Man's judgment by itself is flawed. And here's the thing. Most of you know that. But see, a cross-dressing Calvinist, I'm not making that up. I'm not going to name the guy's channel name, because the last thing I want to do is give that man attention. But a cross-dressing Calvinist, yeah, well, see, I judge, only God could judge me. And he does, you idiot, through the word. And you're a heretic devil. Okay, but anyway, continuing. For I know nothing of myself, yet am I not hereby justified. But he that judgeth me is the Lord. How does the Lord judge you? We've already touched on it through the scriptures. See, and that's why you guys avoid the scriptures, the Jesus who is. Therefore, judge nothing before the time. What does this mean? This means two lost people trying to judge each other on their own righteousness is a joke. Before the time, before you're saved. Because once the Lord saves you, he gives you a perfect standard in which you judge yourself first, but also judge others. Okay? So, therefore, judge nothing before the time, before you're saved. Yeah, you're not saved? Go right ahead. Eat and drink, for tomorrow you die. The pot calling the kettle black. This is talked about in Romans chapter 2. Okay? You do the same things. You're both lost. Trying to judge each other by your own standards. Go right ahead. Roll up another one, buddy. Smoke it up. Go right ahead. Judge nothing before the time, before you're saved. Then see, once you're saved today, the Lord seals you with himself permanently. Once saved, always saved. Okay? All right? Hence, God is in you, and he's going to guide you onto his perfect standard sooner or later. And you judge yourself first here, and then in doing that, you can judge others through a perfect standard. Okay? Therefore, judge nothing for the time until the Lord come. It answers its own question right there. Who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and make manifest the counsels of the heart. And then shall every man have praise of God. That's why you guys want a Bible and not the scriptures. That's why you guys will elevate a man to justify yourselves rather than justifying the scripture. And see, here's the thing that that atheists don't like to acknowledge. I don't believe in sin. Well, that's good for you, you idiot. It doesn't matter. That's irrelevant. Proverbs 29, one verse, verse 26. actually, let's read Proverbs 28, verse 26. He that trusteth in his own heart is a fool, and the fool says in his heart, there is no God. But whoso walketh wisely shall be delivered. Proverbs 29, verse 26. Many seek the ruler's favor, but every man's judgment cometh from the Lord. See, at the great white throne of judgment, you who do not get caught up with the body of Christ, you're going to be judged at the great white throne of judgment. You know that sword that comes out of the Lord's mouth? The sword of the Spirit, the scripture? This is what you're going to be judged by, the scripture. And see, someone who makes it their goal to expose Christianity through the Bibles, they'll be like, God, you're saying God's going to judge me through this? Through a Bible? No. Through the scripture? Yeah. Yeah. But see, here's the thing, Matthew 21, check this one out, brother. Matthew 21. Ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. I will. You think you're saved because you had an emotional experience, but you're still the same old creature. You're not a new creature. See, what makes you a new creature is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You got to remember, dear friend, a change will come from being a new creature. You go around talking, preaching a changed life, the changed life gospel. What predicates a changed life? Being a new creature. Former alcoholics have a changed life. Former porn addicts have a changed life. Former narcotic users have a changed life. Okay? What predicates the, or what is before, excuse me, what is before the change for a saint? Being made a new creature. What makes you a new creature? God in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? But, man. Matthew 21, 33 unto 39. Check this out. Hear another parable. There was a certain householder which planted a vineyard, and hedged it round about, and digged a wine press in it, and built a tawe. I said it that way purposely. And let it out to husbandmen, and went into a far country. And when the time of the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen, that they might receive the fruits of it. And the husbandmen took his servants, and beat one, and killed another, and stoned another. They don't want the new, because the old is better. They didn't want to let go of their authority. They liked being, they ran to the front. They liked being the object of attention. Pretentious. Which a lot of these preachers are. Again, he sent other servants, more than the first, and they did unto them likewise. The last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they will reverence my son. Ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. But when the husbandmen saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him, and let us seize on his inheritance. I will be like the Most High. Ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. You know, in Genesis chapter 3, the very first appearance of Satan, Lucifer, you know, that old serpent, the devil, Satan, number one does what? Yea, hath God said, question what God said. And number two, he accuses the Father, God the Father. Ye shall not surely die. For God knows in the day that ye eat thereof, and your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. It's like, that's not, he's accusing God of lying. That's an accusation. Luke 19, just one verse, verse 14. Luke 19, verse 14. Luke 19, verse 14. You ever been accused of something you never did? Luke 19, verse 14. Luke 19, verse 14. But his citizens hated him. You go ahead and read the context on your own time. But his citizens hated him and sent a message after him, saying, we will not have this man to reign over us. Look back at Matthew 21. Now look at verse 40. When the Lord therefore of the vineyard cometh. Oh, wait, wait, wait. Read verse 39 and 40. And they caught him and cast him out of the vineyard and slew him. We will not have this man to reign over us. This is the heir. Come, let us kill him. And the inheritance will be ours. We will be as gods, knowing good and evil. We will exalt our throne above the stars of God. I will, I will, I will, I will, I will. Five I wills. Five the number of death. What do they do? And they caught him and cast him out of the vineyard and slew him. When the Lord therefore of the vineyard cometh, what will he do unto those husbandmen? Luke 19, verse 27. But those mine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, bring them hither and slay them before me. Vengeance is his, he will repay. It's a scary thing to be against the God who is. Y'all be against the God of Christianity. Please, go ahead. Go. I encourage you to be against the God of Christianity. Because the God of Christianity is not the God of Scripture. It isn't. Okay? Jeremiah 35, one verse. Jeremiah 35, one verse. You want to be their own gods. You want to be your own God. I give respect to a man who at least has the stones to say, yeah, I want sin. I don't want Jesus. I don't want the Jesus of Christianity. Good for you. Good for you. I wouldn't even wish that upon the bloke. Okay? But you don't want the God of the Scriptures either. You don't. Jeremiah 35, verse 15. I have sent also unto you all my servants the prophets, rising up early and sending them, saying, return ye now every man from his evil way and amend your doings, and go not after other gods to serve them. I do this a lot, but the visual. Other gods on your little tablet or health phone. Other gods like the one you look at in the mirror. Again, always, always, always hit this as hard as you can when you get a chance, brother, sister. You run into an atheist, laugh at him. You're not an atheist. Excuse me? Gesundheit, that's the only time I'm going to do that. You do believe in a God. Who are you to... What's your standard of judgment? Yourself. Shut up. You believe in a God. You. Okay? You. Brethren, I don't care what that costs. Atheists, when they come to you with that, well, I don't believe in any, just throw it right back at them. Be prepared, because they don't like that. But that's the point. See, we, the saints, just by telling them truth, cut them to the heart. And that's why the fake hate the saints. because the saints who want to live their life according to Scripture chafe and cut the fake and the non-believers. Okay? Where were we again? Verse 15 again. I have sent also unto you all, in Jeremiah 35, I have sent also unto you all my servants, the prophets, rising up early and sending them, saying, return ye now every man from his evil way, and amend your doings, and go not after other gods to serve them. And ye shall dwell in the land which I have given to you and to your fathers, that ye have not inclined your ear nor hearkened unto me. Why is that? Well, I'll tell you why. I won't tell you. Now see, another dispensation. But that is man. That is mankind. You don't want the God who is. And the God who ain't is the God who the atheists, the Muslims, and all people attack. Satan knew what he was doing, trying to make the God who is look bad. But he can't win. He'll get a victory. But the battle is the Lord's. And the Lord will win the war. Jeremiah 44, verses 15 on to verse 19. Hey, Seventh-day Adventist, I know I offended you. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. That just sounded courteous. I'm not. Your religion that you adhere to was started by a woman. Ask the enemy of mine, Mr. Dudley Do-Right guy, about that. And let him tell you about how to justify a woman preaching in a public thing. Idiot. Anyway, Jeremiah 44, verses 15 on to verse 19. Then all the men which knew that their wives had burned incense unto other gods, and all the women that stood by a great multitude, even all the people that dwelt in the land of Egypt, and Egypt in Pathros, answered Jeremiah, saying, as for the word that thou hast spoken unto us in the name of the Lord, we will not hearken unto thee. Why'd you have to bring up the thing about the woman? Want to get to a man? Go through the woman. Want to get to a family? Go through the woman. You could do it through the man, yes, but look what Satan did in the Garden of Eden. Who did he go to? Eve. Where was Adam? We do not know. Why wasn't Eve by Adam? We do not know. The point is, Satan will first go after who? The weaker vessel. And hey, see, sisters get this. There's nothing wrong with that. You women were created for a specific, glorious purpose. Woman was made for Adam, not Adam for Eve. Definitely not for Steve. Or Kimbo, or Kibo, or whatever that weirdo's name is. Okay? But we will certainly do whatsoever thing goeth forth out of our own mouth. Ooh, here it is. Ye shall be his gods. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Okay, I will be like the Most High. Ezekiel 14, verses 13 and 14, right there, man. To burn incense unto the Queen of Heaven, the Roman Catholic Mary. The Roman Catholic Mary, Queen of Heaven. Semiramis, the wife of Nimrod, who married her own son. Ninus, Tammuz, whatever. So many names. And to pour out drink offerings unto her, as we have done, we and our fathers, our kings and our princes, in the cities of Judah and in the streets of Jerusalem. For then had we plenty of victuals and were well and saw no evil. I'm busy! Sorry. But since we left off to burn incense to the Queen of Heaven, the Roman Catholic Mary, which is not the Mary of Scripture, and to pour out drink offerings unto her, we have wanted all things, and have been consumed by the sword and by the famine. I said it that way purposely. And when we burned incense to the Queen of Heaven, and poured out drink offerings unto her, did we make her cakes to to worship her and pour out drink offerings unto her without our men? Cakes, you know, the little wafer cookie, wine, drink offering, the wine, abracadabra, hocus pocus, really? It's the blood of Jesus and the cookies. Hey, Catholic, the Queen of Heaven right there, there's your Mary. There's your Mary, Catholic. And here's what I got to say about your Mary. Take offense, take a gay. I hope you do. Because you Catholics, you're Satanists. Satanic atheists. You're a Satanist, why aren't you a Catholic?
I missed.
I missed. If you're a Satanist, you should be a Catholic. That's Satan's religion. Perfected. Began in Babylon, crafted in Egypt, perfected in Rome.
You gotta remember that one. There's a, yeah. Babylon Catholic. Okay. Yes.
Okay. But see, that's typical of man. That's mankind. You want to do what you're going to do, you want your cake and eat it too. The God who is opposes that and stands in front and puts his finger on that one thing you lack. That's the God who is. That's the Jesus who is. That's the Jesus who we, the saints, represent. Not Christianity. And not the majority. The majority of these King James Bible-believing Christians. Just a bunch of superficial fluff, the most of you. Petty. Belong on a high school playground, all y'all. Disgusting. Yeah. John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Verses 30 on to verse 32. Now, we're seeing here something very interesting. Because, well, let's go through this. We are going to see that the people who claim to believe on Jesus have their own construct of who he is. But when the Jesus who is describes his requirements. John chapter 8. Check this out. John chapter 8. Let's begin at verse 30 and 32. As he spake these words, many believed on him. Just believe and receive. Repentance is going from unbelief to belief. No, repentance is turning away from yourself that you are your own God. Okay? Being broken. You need to be broken first before you can be fixed. Okay? Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him. Whoa, time out. Okay. If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. Okay? Not one of three gods, but one God comprised of spirit, soul, and body, just like you and I. Okay? Now, look what happens. Verse 33, the justification that these guys go through. These are the guys who say they believed on Jesus. Look at the justification. Verse 33. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou? Ye shall be made free. Justification number one. The magicians in Egypt, they took the rods and threw them down, just like Moses did, and they became serpents. Okay? 39, verse 39, more justification. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Jesus saith unto them, if ye were Abraham's children, ye would do the works of Abraham. They took water out of the Nile and poured it out as blood as well. Okay? 41. Ye do the deeds of your father. Then said they to him, we be not born of fornication. We have one Father, even God. See, the Christian today goes through this very same thing when they're presented with the saint preaching to them the real Jesus. See, they tell you that God has no requirements today, right? The atheists and Muslims attack you Christians on this all the time. Yes, God does have requirements for him to save you today. You have to be broken of your self-righteousness. You have to man up and own up to your responsibility of holding the nail and taking the hammer and nailing him to the cross yourself. You also got to fear him. Fear the Lord. Okay? Those are requirements. But see, Christianity comes on, especially the fake racers and whatnot, they can either replace it with, well, you do this, 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 like Catholics do, or like Calvinistic idiots, it's like, you're elect, so don't worry about it, okay? But they like to jump over the requirement. God requires. And if you don't go the way he has called, the way of the cross, which is death, you're a false convert. End of story. And the false will go through this very similar thing of first justifying themselves. And number of verse 41, the magicians in Egypt called up the frog legs, huh? Oh, I like frog legs. Teriyaki and Tabasco sauce, dude, man. Deep fried and beer batter. Oh, good stuff, man. But they brought up frogs as well. They brought up frogs. So you see their justification of themselves in 33, 39, and 41. Now let's read 42 and verse 44. Jesus, who is one thing you lack, the confrontational Jesus, who he is. Jesus said unto them, if God were your Father, ye would love me, for I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me. Why do ye not understand my speech? Even because ye cannot hear my word. But they believed on him. But they couldn't hear. But they believed. Ye are of your father the devil. And the lusts of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own. For he is a liar and the father of it. And go to Ezekiel 28, verse 18. Thank you, Lord. Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thine iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. It shall devour thee. And I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. So I applaud the guys who dismantle Christians because Christianity is fake. But see, it comes from their own selves. Like it says here, when he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own. I'm saved because I'm elect. I just believe in Z. I think I'm going to heaven because I, you know, didn't went to the mass. Do you get it? Do you get it? And then, what? Okay, now see this whole thing here? They believed. And the Lord's like, wait a minute. Okay. You believe on me, huh? You really believe, huh? Justification of 33. Justification of 39 of themselves. Did you notice that? 39. We be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? Justifying themselves. If I justify myself, my own mouth will condemn me. Job said that. But yet, unfortunately, Job towards the end of the book of Job started justifying himself. Verse 39. They answered and said unto him, Abraham is our father. Self-justification. 41. We have one father, even God. More self-justification. And then the Lord's like, you guys are fake. You lie. You lie. You have your father the devil. And then what happens, brethren? Well, these same people who, I believe. What happens? 48. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, Say we not well that thou art a Samaritan and hast the devil? See, 1, 2, 3. Three things, just like the magicians of Egypt. The rods, the blood, the water to the blood, and the frog legs. Okay? But it comes to a point where they can't fake it anymore. And what do? They turn their thing right back at the person, the saint, as they did to the Lord Jesus Christ, and accuse you. Accuse you of being the bad guy. That's a mark of a false convert. That's a mark of someone who's fake. We all have bad moments. We all make mistakes. But when someone, anger resteth in the bosom of fools. Yeah. How many of you saints have not encountered this? Justification. And then when they are totally made known that they're fake, they turn at the tables and attack you and say, you're the one with the devil. What is that? That's Revelation chapter 12, 9 and 10. I've accused people before. So have you. But see, when you're being accused of being something that you ain't, or something you've never done, Revelation 12, 9 unto 10. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent, the one that was in Genesis chapter 3, called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now has come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Accuser. This you see, like these YouTube guys here, who all they do is attack other people, and they are so inept that they make videos of other people's videos. Because they themselves are inept and can't do anything because they're not saved. They take someone else's video and broadcast it using StreamYard or OBS and let someone... They're fake. All they do is attack people. All they do is accuse. All they do is accuse. Okay? I mean, there are some of these guys who at least try, but that's not saying anything good, but at least they attempt. Others are just, you know, all they're about is showing this guy this. And there's a time and place for everything. Yes, there is. But when you come across someone who all they do is attack other people, and they can't even do anything themselves, but they have to have someone else do their speaking for them. Lazy. Why? Because they ain't saved. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I'm going right at you, bloke. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. See, the accuser of the brethren. Okay? 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter, not the concordance. 1 Peter chapter 3. Verses 8 on to verse 16. Finally, Be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. Not rendering evil for evil, but or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. How do you bless your enemies? Standing for the truth. Giving them truth. Heaping coals of fire upon their head. Okay? That's how. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good, and there is none good but God. Let him seek peace and ensue it. And see, when we saints who are called in the ministry of reconciliation and align our lives rightly divided with the scriptures, okay, and getting instruction in righteousness from the Old Testament, when you walk in accordance with the scriptures, the Lord in you is contrary to that. So you are naturally going to encounter resistance and attack. Okay? You are. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? But and if ye suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. A lot of these apologetics, I'm not apologizing for Christ. I've done that, unfortunately, not knowing, and a brother like got on me pretty good. It's like, Fred, stop that. Stop that. You're right. Okay. But it's like, they come to this and say, we got to answer all your questions. I don't have to answer any of your questions for those of you who don't want to hear the truth. Like if, you know, the Mr. Sunnyside, Dave Murphy, it's like, okay, answer this. It's like, dude, you don't want to hear the truth anyway. Go away. Okay? I'm not wasting my time with guys like that. Okay? You want the truth? You want to hear the truth? That's a different story. If you're asking just to be combative, huh, then go off someplace. Go take a long walk off a short pier. The reason of the hope. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. He is our hope. Okay? So, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. And Jesus Christ is our hope. How can you be so calm during this kind of thing? How can you stand there and take that? Why do you think this way? Why? Want to hear the answer? Always have a sword on you in your back pocket or in your purse, sisters, if you even carry those. Okay? You want to hear about the Jesus of the Scriptures? You want to hear? Verse 16. Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak of you as evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good conversation in Christ. Like we saw in John 8. Justification, justification, justification. Labeled as false, they turn the tables and attack the messenger. Nehemiah chapter 6. Nehemiah chapter 6. See a type of this, the Old Testament, obviously. Nehemiah is after Ezra. Ezra is after 2 Chronicles. Nehemiah 6, verses 5 on to verse 8. This is a good chapter in Scripture to demonstrate to you psychological manipulation and tactics, psychological warfare tactics. Then Sanballat, his servant, then sent Sanballat, his servant, unto me in like manner, the fifth time, the number of death, with an open letter in his hand, accusation against Nehemiah, wherein was written, it is reported among the heathen, and Geshmu saith it, that thou and the Jews think to rebel, for which cause thou buildest the wall, that thou mayest be their king according to these words. There's the accusation, the accuser of the brethren. And thou hast also appointed prophets to preach of thee at Jerusalem, saying, there is a king in Judah. And now shall it be reported to the king according to these words. Now the tactic, the manipulation to bring them into dialogue. Let's have a dialogue. No, you go ahead and talk to a wall. I don't want nothing to do with you. Okay. And see, these streaming guys do this. They have dialogue with devils.
Ooh, that's a good one for you. Dialogue with devils.
Dialogue with devils. These streaming guys that, you know, that take on everybody like whores and talk with. Come now, therefore, let us take counsel together. Then I said unto him, saying, beg your pardon, there are no such things done as thou sayest, but thou feignest them out of thine own heart. Thine own heart. He who trusts in his heart is a fool. God knows my heart. Jeremiah 17:9-10, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings.
Yeah.
Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14, we want 55 on to verse 64. Mark 14, 55 on to verse 64. And the chief priests and all the council sought for witness against Jesus to put him to death, and found none. For many bear false witness against him, but their witnesses agreed not together. And there arose certain, and bare false witness against him, saying, We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made without hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands. Wait. We heard him say, I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and within 3 days I will build another made without hands. But neither so did their witness agree together. Accusation. He was talking about the temple of his body, by the way, too. Okay? And the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, answerest thou nothing? What is this which these witness against thee? Aren't you going to answer the accusation? Answer not a fool according to his folly, lest thou be like unto him. Answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceits. It wouldn't have hurt anyway. But he held his peace and answered nothing. Again, the high priest asked him and said unto him, art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Art thou the Mashiach? Bluntly. Are you the Christ, the anointed one? And Jesus said, I am. Stop. You're right. Jesus never said, I am God. He said, I am. And hey, you look in Exodus chapter 3. Go ahead and read that. He called himself the Father with saying, I am. I am. And ye shall see the Son of Man. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh, sitting on the right hand of power, and coming in the clouds of heaven. And then what did they do? Then the high priest rent his clothes, and saith, What need we any further witnesses? Ye have heard the blasphemy. What think ye? And they all condemned him to be guilty of death. It's like with the Lord on the cross. They say, let him come down and we'll believe him. If the Lord would have like, okay, here I am. They would have tried to kill him anyway with stones because they said he was a devil. But they believed on him. Yeah. But justified themselves three times in John. And then when the Lord called them on it and put his finger on that one thing that you lack, you turn the tables and attack the messenger. Yeah. Yeah. Acts 24. This dispensation. Acts 24. 5 on to verse 15. Acts 24. This is 5 on to verse 15. It's funny because I think actually the bloke might have said this of me. I might be wrong about that. He's called me so many things. But, for we have found this man a pestilent fellow and a mover of sedition among the Jews throughout the world and a ringleader of the sect of the Nazarenes, who also hath gone about to profane the temple, whom we took and would have judged according to our law. And you in Acts 21, he never did that thing at all. But see, death, burial, and resurrection happened. Okay? So those things were futile. Okay? Acts 21. Okay? Let's continue. But the chief captain, Laius, came upon us, and with great violence took him away out of our hands, commanding his accusers to come unto thee by examining, of whom thyself mayest take knowledge of all these things whereof we accuse him. And the Jews also assented, saying that these things were so. Then Paul, after that the governor had beckoned unto him to speak, answered, Forasmuch as I know that thou hast seen that thou hast been of many years a judge unto this nation, I do the more cheerfully answer for myself, because that thou mayest understand that there are yet but 12 days since I went up to Jerusalem for to worship. And they neither found me in the temple disputing with any man, neither raising up the people, neither in the synagogues nor in the city. And they didn't. All lies. Just accusing him. Neither can they prove the things whereof they now accuse me. But this I confess unto thee, that after the way which they call heresy, Christians call the faith that was once delivered unto the saints heresy. Yeah, because the God who is, the Jesus who is confronting the Jesus who is. And when you come to him his way, he's going to tell you what you lack. He ain't going to pat you on the head and say it's okay and give you a pacifier. No, the Jesus who is going to confront you. But this I confess unto thee, that after the way which they call heresy, so worship I the God of my fathers, believing all things which are written in the law and in the prophets, and have hope toward God, which they themselves also allow, they claimed, that there should be a resurrection of the dead, both of the just and unjust. So see, while the fake will justify, and then once they find out, sometimes it takes only one, sometimes it takes more than three, but the point is, they will justify themselves. Ye are they who justify yourselves, but God knows your heart. For what is that? That's Luke 16, verse 15. Okay? Luke 16:15. And he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men. You see that in the comment section of a lot of these King James Bible believing Christians, and also a lot with these Christians as well. You go around and check out their videos, and you just look at the comment section. Leave them alone. Let the blind lead the blind, dude. But you look at them, it's like, oh, wow. Ye are they which justify yourselves before men. God knoweth your hearts. Sure does. That which is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God. Okay? 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. You got to remember this. 1 John chapter 3, verses 13 on to verse 14. Brethren, marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. And who is my brother? You are because you say you are. I think perhaps maybe no. But be not, what does that say? Marvel not, if, my brethren, if the world hates you. Okay, John 15. John 15, 18 and 19. Here they come again. Wow. Hope no one got hurt. John 15, 18 and 19. If the world hates you, I just left my place. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. See, that's the thing. You guys don't want the Jesus who is. You want the fluffy, saccharine, sweet, splendid, sweet, confectionery Jesus who loves you unconditionally, who's not angry at you, who don't worry about it. You're in, don't, you shouldn't do that, but don't worry about it. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. And that doesn't, that's not that stupid Calvinist stuff. Okay, this is before the death, burial, and resurrection too, by the way. But see, those of us saints, we who are saved, the chosen, elect, called, we have the cross, which is death. And 1 John 4, verse 5, and then we'll be done. They are of the world. Therefore, speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. The redemption of the purchased possession could happen at any time. I truly believe that. I truly believe that. Okay? Some of these Christians out there will say, that's heresy. That's heresy. Yeah. I think perhaps maybe no. You know, the Lord says a prophet is without honor in his own house and in his own nation. It's a wonder to me that the majority of people who watch these things that the Lord does here through me, of all people, are from outside of America. But the people who of America, the people are talking to them about the things of the world. Therefore, the world heareth them. See, a saint is someone who is right with God and or saved. Not what Rome tells you a saint is. We, because the Lord is in us, are going to chafe those who are not. Because the true God who is permanently dwells in us. Don't be cast down, dear brethren. This is how it is. It hurts. But rejoice. But rejoice. Because greater is he that is in you, the Lord, than he, Satan, in them that is in the world. Fight the good fight of faith, brethren. Don't fret these Christians. Don't fret these false converts. Don't fret them. If they will hear, great. If you can reason with them, even better. But most of the time, they justify themselves, and then they turn the table and attack you. That's going to be it for this video. And remember, God doesn't love you. Doesn't love you. God loved and gave. You want God's love? You're going to have to die to get it. Die to you, number one. Until that happens, why don't you eat and drink? For tomorrow you're going to die. Yeah. Adios.